I've changed the title, Digitizing the Documentary Veneza, Work and Prospects for the Princeton Veneza Project. I want to note in introducing this that really I am standing here for Marina. We plotted work on this together a number of years ago, but it is really only since she arrived at Princeton that she has been spearheading implementing the vision and creating new visions as well. So, but because she has done so many things already here, I am standing in here. Okay.
Nice spot.
Yes. So, I also want to note that this is part of a very long conversation that we've been having over the past 4 years among researchers working on different aspects of the documentary Veneza, with different people at different meetings that we've had. We have had meetings at Yale, at Princeton, and at UCLA. And as you'll see, we're at an important moment of new work, but also there is work that is not yet started, so that there is time to develop new architecture and interfaces. And part of the goal of these conferences and workshops has been to discuss issues that seem to arise that are specific to documentary materials, but many of which we've learned from conversations here already are not. And to discuss what is most important to our goal, creating a website that can be used equally as a research platform for scholars, as a place to do their work, as a place for scholarly conversation, as a location for micro-publications of editions or translations, and annotations, as well as a resource for pedagogy and the general public. And it's very important to note that although the title is the Princeton Veneza Project, as my presence here, I hope, suggests, this is a site that now involves many institutions. There is a lot of shared excitement and cooperation, and we want even more. And what I'm hoping for is that I will give some overview of what we're doing, and then we'll have some time to talk about some of the goals. So, first of all, if we want to talk about what the documentary Veneza is, there's both definitions, and then there's the question of why a separate website developed for documentary Veneza studies, and why we want to continue building a separate website for documentary Veneza studies. So we know historically that the definition has much to do, in part, as an artifact of Guittine's research. Guittine worked on everyday writing that he felt best revealed society and social attitudes. And we can say that a rough division of the Veneza says that what's documentary is the everyday writing. Writings that are not meant for posterity. They are practical writings of immediate use. And we know that there are categories of writing that fit this definition that Guittine did not make much use of. For instance, the magical documents. There are also documents that are that have a problematic, ambiguous space. Responsa could be meant for immediate use, but were also collected. Piyutin might think of as also indicating liturgical practice at a particular moment, and therefore the question of what is documentary. I know the definition is a problem to be discussed, especially when issues of how we deal with fragments come up. But what we know as scholars of the Veneza, of the documentary Veneza, is that the problems that arise are partially because these are unique exemplars, and each text is precious rather than in perhaps an instance or a variant of a literary text, that they are a window like some other precious windows that we have for other corpora into everyday uses of literacy in this society, And that we also are interested in the fact that the material remains show the varied uses of writing in the society, and also that the supports, the paper and the parchment, show changes and continuities in writing practice for everyday writing. As an approximate corpus, of course, one of the problems with it I will discuss is this problem of approximation. But according to the Free Burkinese Project and their identifications, there are some 32,000 fragments that they have identified, and fragments meaning pieces of paper or shelf marks, that they have identified as documentary in this way. Okay. So, why is there a separate website? First, this is in some ways a legacy. This is a legacy of Geniza research itself. The Princeton Geniza Project was created, as I will mention in a minute, to preserve Wojtyn's work. It is one of the first digital projects ever for the digital humanities. It remains an important resource to documentary scholars of searchable, copyable, usable texts. So it is a place for the digitization of texts, meaning transcriptions, and has been. Now, the other reason that we have thought about, that we have been interested in maintaining a separate website is that as documentary scholars in our discussions, we have noted particular issues that we would like to be worked out on the research website. At the same time, in conversations with the Free Burkinese Project and the Cambridge University Digital Library, we find that they have moved to larger religious collections and to a focus on images rather than transcriptions. The leaders of both projects retain actually very warm relations with the Princeton Geniza Project and want to help us develop new ways of interacting with Geniza texts through building a new website. So what we're trying to do is use this as a place to experiment with the particular needs of scholars working with these one-off texts that are complicated in their physical production and layout on the page. And hopefully, what we hope is that the results of these work can be extended to other corpora, and that you will also have ideas for functionality. And the other thing that has been of particular interest to documentary scholars is the question of interoperability. What does interoperability mean? It means that data can be shared across different websites, that the data that gets created on the Princeton Geniza website can be used directly by another website. The other website doesn't need to copy the data, they can just access it. So that when you search in a different part of a project, you will be able to access the very current work of the Princeton Geniza Project, rather than getting a copy of it that then needs to be updated in different places. The idea of interoperability, also for images, is that that a website can be built that gives access to different sources of data without siloing the data off, and so that when data gets updated in one place, if a new image gets scanned, for instance, by Cambridge, because they're updating their imaging quality, that the Princeton Geniza website would not be left with an old image. They don't have a copy. They just go directly every time that Princeton accesses a Cambridge image, they're accessing it directly from the Cambridge site. So that's the idea of interoperability. The other idea of interoperability is that I just wanted to note that this is particularly important because what we want, for instance, is we have partner projects. For instance, the Arabic papyrology database. Obviously, the Arabic papyri are deeply related to, in time and often in production, to the Cairo Geniza fragments. But these databases have thus far not spoken to each other. And what we want, for instance, is the Arabic papyrologists have also been transcribing their texts, and they have been lemmatizing their texts. And what we want the APD to be able to do is for you, when you search the APD, to also find Princeton texts so that it is easy to compare the papyrological data to the Geniza data. And if the Princeton Geniza project updates a transcription, that is viewed by the APD, right? So that and the same idea is that when you go to Princeton, if you are searching for a word, you want to be able to also find examples of that word in Arabic papyrology database, right? So the idea of interoperability exists in that way. The other example is Trismegistos, which is really a metadata project for papyrological and epigraphal resources, formerly, as they know, Egypt of the Nile Valley, but now expanding to the ancient world in parallel. And though at the moment it's only up to 800, they are also interested in being able to access directly the metadata that we have about documents. So those are two examples. The other reason to be interoperable is you want to be able to make use of shared technology. And the way to think about this, so the technology that is new that we really want to integrate is this thing called IIIF, International Image Interoperability Format. And what I'm showing you here, even though it's not very easy to, these are all screenshots, so I apologize for them. What I'm showing you is a technology that allows you to, IIIF is a format of, a way of formatting images so that they can be captured by, that makes images on any website and any server capturable and usable in a viewing environment. So you'll note here, for instance, this is a Mirador viewer, and it is a way of serving up IIIF images. And what I've been able to do is go directly to here, the University of Pennsylvania, and borrow a manuscript from the University of Pennsylvania that they have digitized, and at the same time, compare it to a manuscript at Harvard University that they have digitized. Note, it was Mirador at Stanford. Stanford created this particular website, but they don't have any of these materials. So I'm going directly to these other websites where the interoperable images allow me to upload them. The other thing that is particularly interesting about Mirador to us, and here's just another example of completely different things that I happen to upload from other sites. And you'll note also that there's a scroll bar to scroll through the whole manuscript. And they've been discussing the ability to create collections of manuscripts that you can scroll through. Or, for instance, collections of individually created collections of Geniza documents that you can scroll through. The other thing that is important about Mirador is I've shown you here an annotation. So what's exciting is you can make you can block out a section of text, and you can block it out as a rectangle, but also as a polygon, or even as a squiggly line, and circle a particular area of text and make your own annotations on them. Now, the other thing that's really important about annotations is it's not just that you can make annotations, that your annotations can be private, they can be only for you. So as a working scholar, you can be making temporary comments that you can then remove later, but they can also be shared with a specific group. So there's grouping possibilities, and they can also be made, they can be made public. They can also be made permanent. So for instance, some people have been using these to create a layer that is a permanent transcription that you can, as an annotation of a particular line or a particular passage or a particular paragraph. So that is, and what we would like is that we want to be able to develop the software of a new interface for the Princeton Geniza that makes use of the developing software that they're building at places like Stanford, so that the utilities that we create that are specific can be shared with others, and as others create new utilities, like this collection tool that someone created recently, that they also can then be shared back. Those are sort of the pleas for interoperability and not siloing. Just to recall for you, obviously other people in the room can tell the history of the Princeton Geniza project better, but just so we know what it is, in 1986, Mark Cohen and Avram Yudovich applied for an IBM grant to get computers so that they could preserve parts of Guettein's unpublished work. And that is what they thought was most important were the hundreds, as it turned out, thousands of transcriptions that Guettein had not published of Geniza documents, what we call Guettein's type texts. Now, over the years, there was also funding from Freeburg to create new transcriptions of Geniza documentary materials, most of which came from what was known of documentary materials from Guettein, but also which came from the scholarship of researchers like Mark Cohen and Avram Yudovich in their scholarship. And so the outcome of this, as of 2015, if you have used the Princeton Geniza project, is some 4,350 fragments were transcribed, about half of which are Guettein and about half of which are new transcriptions. And the goal of the project in general is to make texts available and searchable. And that is a way of seeing digitization as primarily textual, not just image digitization. But there is a real problem of history. There's a problem with this history, that what we're looking at is a cherry picking of Geniza documents. And it's not clear how representative they are of anything but what was either most readable or what reflected Guettein's interests. So, the big question that had came up in meetings about the documentary Geniza is, what we really need is a survey of the entire documentary Geniza. It is embarrassing that we cannot even say how many documents there are or what types are most common. We have intuitions, but are those intuitions based on Guettein or are they based on actual needs? What does the documentary Geniza actually look like? How do we map it? So we had meetings on typology, but the question also is, how do we manage the complexity of individual artifacts and the history of cataloging? As Marina talked about, we want to capture the fact that paper is reused, and the kind of information about the relationship between compositions, use of paper, and the kinds of text that call for different kinds of support. There's two goals. The interim goal has been to add new materials and create an interim site with new functionality, and to agree on data structures, which have been the subject of huge conversations. And at the same time, to solve a problem that for a long time, if you wanted to correct metadata, you had to write to a computer specialist in order to get the data on the website changed. We actually want to make the data editable by the computer. And then the developmental goal for 2018 to 2019 is to develop new architecture and interfaces. So just a brief map of current work. What we're looking at in the Princeton Geniza project is so the old PGP had 4,350 documents, and the first object was to get more consistent metadata. So there was the going through the old PGP and writing 700 pieces of descriptions for documents that were transcribed but not described. And then to be done is to plug holes in the transcriptions where transcriptions are incomplete or problematic. The second aspect that has been completed, so you'll note in burgundy what we have is things that are finished. The second aspect was to digitize Goitein's Nachlass, that is to, and this is in progress at the moment, so basically to put Goitein's index cards onto the website. As we all know, Goitein's, not all know, but as anyone in the documentary Geniza world knows, Goitein's index cards are an incredible mine of information about particular shelf marks, whether or not they showed up in his work, about individuals, about topics that he collected on. So the idea has been to scan, to take the scans of these that were made many years ago, to disaggregate them and sort them by shelf mark, to also to re-index and upload these, and then to go through and also get any other Goitein transcriptions that have not been put up on the website, and also to start putting up translations. And so the other thing that, so the other work that's in progress is what we call the low-hanging fruit. That is to take published transcriptions that we can find in various volumes. So some of them are listed here, and especially the problem of all of the editions that were created in specific articles, a vast corpus that is very difficult to find, and to get those onto the website. So to take advantage of that low-hanging fruit. So that's a project of creating new data. The other projects are also about creating new metadata, and in the case of the JTS documents, which are now at Princeton, as they renovate the library, Marina got a special grant, which will allow her to work with postdocs or graduate students?
Postdocs. Two of them are in this room.
To go through the JTS documents, which is the second largest corpus, and identify all the documentary materials in the JTS corpus. As she notes, an estimated 4,000, describe some of them and transcribe some of them. And the third aspect of this is really about data and about how we organize data. And it is about how we take all the information that all of us individual scholars have collected about particular documents or particular people or particular objects, or in my case, particular travels, and take those spreadsheets and turn them into part of the website. So that is the other big project that we're trying to get to. So I realize my time is running out. So what I want to go quickly through and just note that we had an incredibly long series of debates about how to define the kinds of documents that are in the documentary Geniza. Cataloging, metadata, the constant problem of the digital humanities. And basically, Marina and Eve came up with an incredibly complicated tree structure with hundreds of categories, which came out of discussions at Yale, which were about all of the various specificities of how people understood writing different kinds of documents. And then after another meeting in Vienna, we decided that what we really needed to do was collapse this structure and really only have five big categories of documents, letters, legal documents, lists and tables. Lists are one column, tables are things with more than one column. Paraliterary, which is a troublesome category because it includes things like amulets, but also medical prescriptions. But don't worry, I'll mention the fact that we can sort this out better in a moment, and then state documents. What was decided to do instead of subdividing types was to allow there to be tags that would subdivide types, so that things could be tagged according to when people sub-identify corpora, they could create a tag for that whole corpus. And also, people could tag according to questions of interest. So this data structure is actually open to documentary ENISA specialists, so that we can do some of this work of adding tabs. But the other thing is that you should note about this is that the ID is not the same as the shelf mark. And that is because we allow there to be more than one item per shelf mark, following the fact that, in fact, shelf marks, as we know, often contain in the documentary ENISA more than one object of writing. So Menachem asked us yesterday, how do you categorize a shelf mark that has more than one document on it? And I want to get back to that problem in a moment. But basically, to show you the new features of the website, it still has the old website things that it has a description, but you'll note it now has types and tags, but then it also has the transcription that is fully available to use. But you will also note if you click on legal, you will note that you now get the fact that there are 1,311 records that are found in the legal corpus. Equally, if you click on bills of sale, the tag, you'll find 53 records there. The other thing that has already been done is you can also find documents that have not been transcribed and or described, but another 3,000 documents that were found through Loewenstein's index cards. And so what you get here is an image of the index card, and then you can click on the index card itself and see Loewenstein's index card for the shelf mark. Finally, I just want to note that the big problem with data structure that we need to solve is the fact that very elegantly in her talk talked all about documents that get reused, and the fact that we see often more than one text on different sides of a document, but also more than one text on even a single side of a document. And at the same time, we also have the problem that shelf marks, like this one from ENA, can contain more than one piece of paper, or, as Menachem pointed out, shelf marks can contain many pieces of paper. So the real problem that the computer scientists have pointed out to us, and this is where I will finish up, is that what we have here is a many-to-many problem. That one piece of paper can contain more than one text, like Marina's reused pieces of state decree, but a text may lie on more than one piece of paper, joins, and of course a shelf mark may contain more than one piece of paper. So what we've discovered is that we need a new architecture. We need to have a unique identifier that should be a single text on a single fragment of paper. This is very complicated for us to understand, but the computer scientists assure us that this will allow us to create two kinds of composite objects. A shelf mark that comes from a composite of texts on each side of paper, and a document or a composition that is a composite of text that may be on both sides of a single sheet of paper, maybe on one side of several pieces of paper, or maybe a simple complete text on one side of paper. And that the goal of this is to have the metadata structure that we have metadata about shelf marks that are individual pieces of paper, but also that we have metadata about each composition, each document. And I will not go through all of the essentially, we have an incredibly long wish list of things that we want the new website to be able to do, but I'm afraid I have run out of time talking about all the wonderful things that are already going on. So We welcome questions, discussions. I know this is a longer session, so hopefully if there's not time now, there'll be time also at the end to discuss what the issues are. Great.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I have to acknowledge that it was my honor in 1993 to work with Mr. Mark Bowman. So remember, Mr. Batkin, we got all the information to the business. I worked for 2 years in that program. Anyway, any questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you, Jessica. This is super. I think the tagging functionality is very important and very useful. Do you envision at some point being able to filter with multiple tags?
Absolutely.
Great.
So this tagging is at the very beginning. What we really want to be able to do, and I know creating shareable and private scholarly databases within the site is not only collections of linked documents and new columns for data, but a way to use tags within transcriptions to create databases for parts, for persons, for things, for formulae, for what I worked on, which is, you know, blocking off diplomatic sections of text and comparing them. So this is very much the goal.
Right. So if we can click on like legal documents, 1221, mm-hmm. NAHRAI, you know, the
yep.
union of those is 16
yep.
and here they are. That's super.
That would yeah. be that is a goal, definitely. To be able to search by multiple tags. Yeah.
Short
comment
it's very important question. I just want to offer a calendar. I think it's like one of the categories that you mentioned, maybe we need to.
Calendars, you said? It's fire literary. For us, that's fire literary. But that's this thing. Any categorization is going to come from the perspective of the interests of the people who are creating the categories, right? Mm-hmm. We just acknowledge that. Ultimately, in the fullness of time, it would be nice, in the interest of interoperability, for everybody to sit down and kind of agree and parse this out. But for us, since our focus is on the documentary corpus, we kind of need a catch-all category for those borderline things. So
And again, this was not just the documentary Bonanza, this was also the papyrologist. So when we met together and talked about this, we had very complicated discussions, but we also wanted to end up with some very simple categories that we could then share between the two projects. So that was the goal.
Yes.
So congratulations, this gives a good appetite, so something to look forward to. Can I say something about identifiers? Seems like a very crucial question, because you have several websites working, as you say, and then some shelf marks could have as many as 30 fragments or so.
Mm-hmm.
Seems to me crucial that there would be some central agreement or authority or somebody that you will have the same identifier as an FGP number, for example. When,
mm-hmm.
when there's an FGP number, perhaps you should use it, or maybe have a committee with FGP and give numbers and so that you won't have various...
So the idea is obviously to link the identifiers to the FGP numbers, right? But the link with FGP would have to be at the level of shelf mark, because that's where the FGP numbers are. That's where their identifiers are. Do you see what I'm saying?
So you're saying that with that shelf mark that has 40 fragments in it.
Yes.
So you'll have to have another identifier.
Yes.
This
right, and this was actually interesting because Menachem said Yaakov Shweka actually thought that maybe there should be separate identifiers for each side of a document already, but of course in the documentary case it's even more complicated than that, right? But the idea is, yes, very much that we would be linked at the data would be linked exactly at the site where the data links, right? So the data links at the composite site of shelf mark to FGP.
So yeah, I can say, well, we face similar things in the Dead Sea Scrolls where the fragments are even,
yeah.
a lot smaller.
Yes,
surprisingly less websites that do their architecture and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So we give a number for each tiny fragment.
Exactly.
That's a, there's a identifier for each of them. And now, those that the Prismetistos and the Jeep data bank of Papyrus and so on, they know how to handle these. They have very good coordination, those Greek Papyrus, between various databases.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The
FTP
identifier. Number, the identifier of the image, not the shell pump. This is first. Now, we are talking about different entities already. The shell pump is an entity, not an identifier, it's an entity.
Right.
And an image is an entity, it's not. So, you can identify different entities with different identifiers. And a text is a different entity. So, when you are talking about separate entities, and of course, separate entities require separate set of identifiers. That's in one business, okay? So if you read that, if that data starts to understand that after we deal with different entities, shelf mark, page, the image, text, all of these are different entities. And of course, you can, you should give set, a different set of identifiers to different entities. Okay? And then to link between them. This text belongs, this image belongs to this shelf mark.
Exactly.
And so on.
Yes, I think that you explained it much more clearly than I did. Thank you.
One last question.
I have a question about the cataloging of the basic cataloging of types.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me very similar to the problem we had of identifying genres in the folktale archives.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on the one hand, we want to create a common language, you know, for researchers. On the other hand, you don't want to reproduce automatically current research. You want to allow for serendipity, you want to allow for new horizons.
Right.
And I think one, admittedly, ours is a much smaller, I mean, it's a much smaller scale, and maybe that's why we could afford doing it or carry on doing it, but we have different categories that are added on to the genre, which allow for multiple entries into the same text. So it creates a multi-directional connection between texts that you otherwise wouldn't have reached.
Right, and this is the idea of using the tag. So for instance, the tag Napre includes things that are legal, because there are certainly legal documents associated with Napre Bindisi, and it includes letters, because there are many letters associated with him, right, and it includes a will. So the idea is that exactly that we wanted to have some categories, but we wanted the flexibility for things to be able to be found in other ways. Absolutely. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I wasn't clear about what the categories were besides authorship.
The categories for the documentary Geniza?
Yeah.
So the very simple categories. Letters?
No, those are types.
Yep.
I'm talking about the connections.
The connections between subcategories.
Yeah.
So again, there was an enormous tree of categories, right? So letters, subtypes of letters, subtypes of letters. But it broke down in various ways because this was, again, there were extremely long discussions about this. But for instance, would you want to categorize a petition in the category of letters, or would you want to categorize a petition in state documents, right? A petition takes the form of a letter, but does it make sense to be a state a special category? So instead, we have a tag for petitions, and petitions can call up letters that are private petitions, and it can also call up state documents that are petitions.
So in a nutshell, the difference is that in the incredibly complicated system that Eve and I devised, all the types were in a hierarchical tree.
Right.
And the idea of kind of just throwing that away was to say, we don't want it to be hierarchical anymore, and tags
and it allows for scholarly produced collections. And that's really, you know, because it's a research website, instead of creating a rule from above. These are the genres, which, you know, we also heard from the papyrologists was a huge and endless debate, that it instead allows scholars to be making collections.
One recommendation and one thought.
Yes.
A recommendation, there is the information systems here that the guard professor Ilan Chi showed you. It's part of a project dealing with archaeological artifacts that were excavated from in Cyprus, mm-hmm. but then scattered all over the world. And they are doing it dual work. One is based on visual analysis in which, you know, they just fix the hand of a sculpture to the rest of the body when the hand is in a museum in Paris and the rest of the body is in Vienna. But the other is to read through the catalogs of different museums that have their different structure and to be able to create a kind of unique catalog of every artifact that left Cyprus whenever. I don't know exactly what they're going to do in terms of how to, of the technology in this part of the project, but it might be also relevant for us to learn from them.
Yes.
So that's the recommendation. And the other is a thought that, that maybe another conceptual entity mm-hmm. should enter into our discussion, which is the relationship. Mm-hmm. Namely, the relationship between two fragments. Mm-hmm. And there are many kinds of relationships, and they have to be expressed. So mm-hmm. for example, two fragments that belong to the same physical object originally, mm-hmm. that's one kind of relationship. But various fragments that belong to the same, book, literary, okay, is another kind of relation. Now we can yep. retrieve those relationships from tags, mm-hmm. but it is, but I it is possible that that introducing the relationships as relationships into a database will enable us later on some other modes of analytics of the database. It's a very, and this actually this thought was provoked when I was surfing my heritage, which is a website of genealogy.
Mm-hmm.
And then you see, I thought, oh, maybe we can think about everybody as a fragment as a person, okay? And how we can make the commitment, and then you know that you just put your grandmother, and then you have this one came from the same shtetl, and the other one is probably a relative, and so on. Okay, just a
I mean, when we had this discussion, basically we had, there is a bit of a tree structure so that the book or the larger composition just came above as another layer of unity. I'm not sure in terms of, this is a very good question that we'll bring back to. We have monthly meetings now about how to put this architecture together, but to discuss this question. Thank you so much.
Relationships beyond hierarchy.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jessica.
Okay.
Thank you very much.